Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Superhuman by Evan Currie, narrated by Kevin T. Collins. Prologue. It was an unremarkable world, orbiting an unremarkable star. The star was neither excessively hot nor particularly cold. The world circled neither close nor far as planets went, and the system itself was far enough from the center of the galaxy that it had escaped attention for many, many eons. In all truth, there had been no pressing need to observe it. It provided its power, unchecked and uninterrupted, since it had been spun off of a greater galactic mass according to the plan, and those who had created it were well satisfied with its performance. Until now. A long-range probe happened upon it, mostly by accident, in fact. It had been intended to observe a system 38 light-years closer to the center of the galaxy, a system rated as much more likely to harbor life. Not this wholly unremarkable system at the outer edge of the galactic system, which rated only a sub-average chance of developing even the most rudimentary form of the life disease. A stray signal had been intercepted while en route, prioritizing an immediate diversion to this distant star. Decryption of the signal made it clear that it was from a sentient source and a high likelihood of being from life. Life was a plague on the galaxy, possibly even the universe in its entirety. It appeared in the least likely of places and spread with frightening and maddening ease. A stray meteor strike against an infected world could send infected spores across light years to infect some other soon-to-be-blighted world. Keeping the disease in check had required every resource available, and for a time, it seemed a losing battle. Those dark times were long past, of course, but eternal vigilance was the price of freedom. And so the guardians of the galactic worlds continued to stand their watch, as they always would. The luck of finding the blue-green world was briefly calculated but given up on when the odds came back in the infinite and still climbing. A sliver of time later, the probe finished its report and the odds climbed even higher. This world was long past being overwhelmed by the life disease. They were infesting every aspect of its surface and even deep into its structure. The life was already disrupting the energy gathered from the world, though its insidious tendrils were only now beginning to delve into the power generated from that star. It was a world almost ready to go to seed. A convergence was created of they to whom the probe reported, gathering in quick succession in search of a solution. There was no battle force within years of the world, centuries most probably. The closest was currently operating three sectors closer to the galactic core, persecuting a war of extermination against a particularly invasive species that had populated three worlds in the Draco sector of this galactic power mass. That species had held off extermination for three decades so far, a tiny slice of time to the observers, but far too great a time to leave this new species alone. They were already launching spores to other worlds within their system. Another century could see them spreading across the stars. Unacceptable. The convergence consulted briefly before coming to the inevitable decision. The system had to be purged in order to preserve the continued well-functioning of the power-gathering system. The taint of life would soon begin to seriously affect the power pouring from the star in the same way that the world itself was now irrevocably soured. The probe was the only asset they had in that area of the galaxy, and its capabilities were known. They sent it an order, demanding more information. The probe was of a long-range, independent reflex type, designed to turn life upon itself when encountering low-threat species. This was a different matter, something new. None of the convergents would remotely classify this species as low-threat. That made their course of action somewhat unprecedented. Unprecedented, but not impossible. A suggestion to hold was made, but rejected. The convergents elected to follow procedures, despite them not being precisely tailored for the current situation, and instructed the probe to follow its base protocols, despite misgivings. Basic truths held at all levels of complexity. Life was predictable. It always turned upon itself. The solution that worked for microscopic life would have to suffice for the macroscopic form, at least as a delaying card. When the next battle force was freed up, the planet would be rendered down to its component atoms, the life force destroyed in perpetuity. If the star was infected by then, well, that too would be collapsed. It would be a minor loss. It was only a medium-level producer among trillions of redundant backups, after all. And so the order went out, not from the galactic center, though that was where the convergence was normally focused. It came from beyond the dimensional veil, instantly triggering the probe's cytoforming protocols. Had the convergence considered the matter further, it might have noted that genocide was not strictly necessary at this junction. Rather, a mere slowing of the species in question would suffice and be much simpler. They did not, and so they merely conveyed a simple order to the probe. Proceed. The probe's intelligence was rudimentary compared to its master's, and so it received the order with equanimity and closed once more on the world to begin a more detailed analysis. The atmosphere contained many elements toxic to the majority of life forms to evolve so far within this galaxy and others. The probe noted those toxins briefly, determining that the local life apparently both fed the toxin levels and neutralized them. The contradiction was noted, logged, then pushed aside. The world was too badly infested for an application of toxins to be sufficient to exterminate the problem anyway. It began a sequential profile on the species within the blue-green world, classifying each by virulence, virility, rate of expansion, and overall lethality. The classification process lifted one genome to the probe's attention quite quickly. The probe advanced its agenda by the protocols, adjusting for the complexity of the genome involved, and began to look for the most aggressive strains. Pure lethality was optimal, but blind aggression was the primary requirement. Chapter 1. Fort Worth, Texas.
"I'll see you on Monday, hun," former Marine Captain Alexander Corwin Hale said as he leaned over and kissed his wife. Deborah Hale leaned into his kiss, cupping his face with her hand over his shoulder, and smiled at him in the mirror as he hugged her from behind.
"You have a good time, Alex. Tell your friends hi from me, okay?"
"You got it, love." He grinned boyishly, cupping her hips as he pressed against her one last time, then retreated back out of the bathroom. He picked up his leather biker armor from where it was hanging on a bedpost, hanging it over one arm as he walked out of the bedroom and down the hall. In his den, he keyed open the combination to his gun safe and withdrew his Fabrique Nationale 5.7C pistol, along with his Texas carry permit, and clipped the weapon to his belt before looping the leather jacket over his shoulder and going downstairs. He'd been in the Marines for 10 years, 7 of those assigned to Detachment 1, and later MARSOC, the Marine Force Detached to Special Operations Command, SOCOM. And during that time, he'd learned the ingrained reflex to go nowhere unarmed. Over the years, most of his peers had stayed firmly in the comforting embrace of the old standby of the Corps, the Colt 1911, in one of its myriad forms or another. Hale had always been fond of the Browning high power for himself, even though the 9mm pistol lacked some of the stopping power of the 1911. When he'd finally had to give up his old and faithful pistol, forced by the wheels of time to move on, he'd gone with its spiritual descendant, the FN-57. Luckily for him, by that time he'd been assigned full-time to SOCOM, and the slightly exotic ammunition wasn't a problem. With his companion secured safely on his belt, he closed the gun safe and left his den, going downstairs and crossing into the garage. Once there, he smiled for a moment before saddling up on his custom-built chopper and thumbing the electric starter. The engine roared to life as he thumbed the automatic door opener to free him and his bike from the confines of the garage. The long weekend beckoned, and Alex Hale twisted the throttle of his chopper and roared out into the Fort Worth streets. Arlington, Texas.
"We've got a problem, Warren." The scrubby-looking man idly brushed his dirty beard with one hand, then spit on the ground as he leaned back in the wide seat of his Harley.
"Is that so, Mickey?"
"Yeah, Warren, that's so."
Mickey, a 250-pound mountain of a man, glared at the smaller man, trying to get across the seriousness of the situation to his diminutive boss. Warren, however, didn't look bothered in the slightest.
"The machine?"
"You know it's the goddamned machine," Mickey growled. "They hit our meth labs in Abilene and San Angelo, killed 30 of our guys, and promised to take us out during the big biker bash this weekend."
"Well, I guess we're gonna hit them first," Warren said calmly, dismounting his bike and standing face to face with his lieutenant.
"With what?"
Warren smiled, nodding to the warehouse they were stopped outside.
"Walk with me, Mick."
The small man turned away then, walking calmly away. A few steps away, he looked back and smiled, his yellowed teeth caked with food and decay.
"Bring your boys, Mick. They'll like this."
Mickey watched him walk for a moment, then shook his head and started after him, waving at the others arrayed around them.
"Come on, you dipshits. Let's see what he's got up his sleeve."
15 outlaw bikers got up off their asses, grumbling a bit as they followed the two men into the warehouse. Warren produced a key to the padlocked door, tossing the lock on the ground as he threw the door open and stepped in, and Mickey followed close behind. Inside was dark, the empty maw of the huge building seeming to swallow up light faster than the sun above could produce it. Their steps echoed in it, the sound vanishing into the depths, only to return a moment later.
"Jesus fucking Christ," someone cursed. "Where's the fucking lights?"
"Shut up, Sanders," Mickey growled, looking around for the lights himself.
A moment later, a flash and glare caused them all to lift their hands up to cover their eyes as the place was flooded.
"Fuck! Christ, man! What the hell? Jesus!"
Warren's distinctive slow chuckle echoed through the warehouse around them as the men slowly lowered their hands, looking around and squinting. After a long moment, the glare faded away and they got a good look at what surrounded them. Eyes widened in shock, and the previous bout of cursing was repeated.
"Holy shit, what the fuck? Jesus Christ, Warren," Mickey blew. "What the hell is this?"
Warren smiled slowly, extending his hands out to either side, taking in all the crates stacked around him.
The best Chinese, Russian, and French military weapons available on the free market, Warren smiled, gesturing to a stack across from him. Norinco Type 107 assault rifles and over 100,000 rounds for them.
He pushed Mickey out of the way, walking over to another crate.
5 LaCroix Samurai grenade launchers, with 50 grenades each.
Someone else cursed, but it was a hushed sound, and both Mickey and Warren ignored it as the smaller man guided his larger friend over to another stack of crates.
Russian revolvers. You'll love these, pal.
Warren grinned, flipping open one of the crates and pulling a weapon from it.
Here.
Mickey accepted the weapon, frowning at it as he flipped it over in his hand. It didn't look like any revolver he'd ever seen. The cylinder was almost twice as long as it should be, and he frowned as he thumbed it open.
What the hell does this fire?
They used to fire some obscure Russian round, Warren chuckled, grinning widely, but I had them all modded to fire these.
Mickey caught the bullet, tossed at him, and stared as he recognized it.
Jesus, Warren, this thing is .223. This is a fucking rifle round.
I know. I love those wacky Russians. The mangy biker grinned mockingly.
Mickey looked at the pistol in his hand, then at the rifle round it was designed to fire, and shook his head. The bullet was a 5.56mm NATO standard round, an arguably obsolete round in military circles, but obscenely powerful for something fired from a handgun, of all things. Mickey had served for a while in the Army before being discharged over an issue he had with his unit sergeant, and he knew the power involved in a rifle. The recoil on the revolver would be a bitch, to be sure, but it should put a nice hole in anything it was pointed at, especially if Warren had got a hold of some decent ammo instead of the crappy full metal jacket shit the Army issued.
What do you think? Mickey looked up, blinking.
What?
I said, what do you think? Warren asked, smirking.
You think we can take the machine?
Mickey considered it, looking around the warehouse, and slowly began to nod.
Yeah, it's workable.
Warren grinned wide.
But we'll need everyone, Mickey warned. No shitting here, Warren. The machine have us outnumbered 3-1. We can't hold anything back.
Fair enough, Warren smirked, slapping Mickey on the shoulder, then turned to the others.
You heard him, boys. I want every man we've got, every old lady, every fucking wannabe that wants to put on our colors. All of them. The Blood Ravens are going to war.
Ranger HQ, Dallas, Texas. Ranger Simon Wood dropped his coat onto his desk, ignoring it when it slid off and took a half stack of papers with it.
Captain, I just had a talk with one of my CIs, he said, walking into his captain's office without bothering to knock. The older man behind the desk looked up at him, sighing in tolerated exasperation.
And what does this CI have to say that requires you to barge in on me while I'm on the phone?
Wood looked at his captain for the first time, then shrugged and slammed the door shut before taking a seat across the desk.
Fine, Captain Paul Stedman said before putting the phone back to his ear. Look, I'll call you back.
When the phone clicked in its cradle, Stedman nodded once to the younger ranger.
All right, Simon. Let's hear it.
You know I've been cultivating a CI in the Ravens, right?
Stedman nodded. CIs, or confidential informants, were a necessary, though sometimes distasteful, part of police work. CIs were rarely the bloom of humanity, and dealing with them could strain the toughest of cops, but they were part of being a good peace officer rather than just some lab technician examining evidence.
A good CI could let a cop head off a crime before it happened. So Stedman listened when one of his rangers came in with word from one of them.
You get him flipped?
Wood nodded.
Yeah, I did. Almost wish I didn't, in a funny way.
Stedman raised an eyebrow. That was a switch. Wood was one of the men destined for Ranger Legend, which was a lofty destiny indeed. Talking like that wasn't something he'd have expected from the man.
Talk to me, the captain ordered, then and there.
Word is the Ravens are preparing for war.
The machine?
The question sounded more like a statement, so Wood just nodded and went on. My CI says that the Raven's boss, Warren Keegan, has got a hold of some heavy-duty arms, and he's going hunting this weekend.
That's insane, Stedman said instantly. Keegan's only got, what, 200 guns total?
Closer to 800, Wood corrected, holding up a hand against the captain's protest. He's calling in everyone even remotely connected with the Ravens.
All right, fine. That still leaves him outnumbered more than 2-1.
Wood nodded, which is where the guns come in. The word is he's got military ordnance.
Everyone has military ordnance nowadays, Wood, Stedman scowled.
Indeed, since the ongoing terror wars in the Middle East had begun to regularly spill over to U.S. soil, as well as British soil, Canadian soil, Australian soil, and Japanese soil, to name but a few, the number of weapons reaching the black, white, and gray markets had increased exponentially. Assault rifles, once the exception, were now rapidly approaching the normal sort of thing for law enforcement to encounter during the execution of their duties. I mean explosives, high-caliber rifles, heavy machine guns, and maybe some anti-armor stuff.
What? Stedman burst.
How?
Don't know that yet.
But if it's right, Captain Paul Stedman, Texas Ranger, fell back in his chair.
Dear Lord, we're looking at a bloodbath.
You got it, Cap. Convention Park, Arlington, Texas.
Hail!
Alexander grinned as he slipped his half-shell helmet off and set it on the handlebars of his chopper.
How's it hanging, Rosie?
Rosalia Rosie Ramirez grinned over at her former captain, flipping him a mock salute as the former Marine turned history professor returned the salute with gusto. Alex Hale had met Rosalia Ramirez when she was about as raw as they came, a private first class in the Corps specialized in communications and field electronics. He'd been a lieutenant then, in command of a squad of Force Recon Marines, and almost as green as she was. Between them, they'd given the squad sergeant more than one sleepless night, and he'd reciprocated by making sure that if he couldn't sleep, then by God, neither would they. Spanish-American, Rosalia had the classic looks of her heritage, giving her a deceptively soft look that fooled no one when they saw her in uniform. She'd worked like a dog to get where she was when they met, and kept on working twice as hard as any man in the squad just to prove she was half as good. It hadn't been an easy time for women taking up combat roles, especially in the tradition-steeped Marine Corps, but she had made one hell of a Marine. Almost no women did. The burnout rate for women in the Corps was obscene, but Alex always had Rosie pegged as a career Marine. Proving him wrong again, she'd retired shortly after he had and gone into business for herself as an electronic security consultant. Last he heard, she was making 4 times what he did and working less than half the hours. Alex smiled at that thought. The times, they do change. She snagged a beer from an ice chest at her feet and tossed it to Alexander.
Drink up, Cap. The others won't all be here till tonight, so you may as well.
Alex caught the beer easily enough, kicking the stand down on his chopper and popping the tab on the can.
I'm the first?
She laughed
Not a chance, Cap. He smiled, nodding. Tea? Natch, she replied with a half grin. He chuckled and nodded. Of course.
Hey, do I hear my name being taken in vain?
Trent T. Treadwell asked, grinning as he appeared from behind a stand of bushes, doing up his zipper. All in all, that was as typical an introduction from T as he'd ever got. The slim blonde man was a Navy man, a SEAL by vocation, and not a Marine, for which Alex again thanked the good Lord above. The Corps had to have some standards, after all, and T violated every standard he'd ever run up against. T, everything about you is in vain, Rosie replied, rolling her eyes as he snagged another beer. Jesus Christ, T, that's your fourth.
Yeah, well, I just got rid of the last three, so I need to tank up.
Getting tanked never was your problem, T, Alex said, smiling despite himself as he shook his head.
You know it, Cap.
The slim, blonde-haired man grinned, kicking over a bench a couple times until he had moved it closer, then sat down.
Hey, you hear from Sarge?
Alex shook his head.
Not in a while. Couple months.
You think he's coming?
I don't know, T, Hale shrugged. He said he'd be here.
Then he'll be here, Rosie put in. Sarge always does what he says.
Yeah, they nodded in agreement.
Yeah. Aggression wasn't a difficult thing to find. It never was. The probe didn't feel emotions or make any judgments that another intelligence might consider moral, but it felt a rudimentary satisfaction in that fact. Life was aggression, which made its job easier. In this case, it was simply a matter of running the numbers. Profile by aggression, sophistication, and effectiveness. Adjust by relative factors in the surrounding environment, and then compile the final data. Simple, mathematical, clean. It always was. The probe plotted the figures quickly and reviewed them again. It discounted certain high results when relative environmental stress indicated a natural mean and adjusted its focus to look at high results relative to local environments. There were more than enough of those to choose from. The roar of motorcycle engines seemed to make the world itself shudder as the gang thundered along the long, empty road, a string of humanity that stretched out for miles. Cars behind them kept their distance, leaving the gang plenty of road to themselves as they drove, and cars ahead of them were quick to find other roads to their destination. In the lead of the machine rode an obese man on a heavily reinforced trike, a large chopper-style front end powered by a powerful car engine and a chopped Volkswagen rear. He was born Carl Eugene Monroe of Cincinnati, Ohio, but no one called him that anymore, not even his mother. To the machine and all of its 1,600 members, he was Rev. That was all. Just three letters. Rev. A lot of people wondered why that name, but few asked. Those who did got conflicting answers, assuming that Rev was in a good mood. If he wasn't, they just got the living daylights beat out of them, if they were lucky. Damn few people bothered to ask anymore. Rev was leading his gang toward Arlington, where they were going to take out the Ravens once and for all and consolidate the machine's control over the drug traffic in North Texas. The machine had the guns and the men, so Rev knew that the Ravens wouldn't be flying much longer in Arlington or anywhere. Beside him, oblivious to the rules of the road and the swerving cars that hit the shoulder to avoid slamming headlong into him, rode Rev's strong right arm, a wiry, dirty blonde who went by the name Gustav. Gustav wore dirty denim, jacket, and jeans, with the machine's colors stitched across his back and a small patch on his shoulder that read simply 1%.
Like the rest of the machine, and even their brothers in the Blood Ravens, Gustav gloried in the title One Percenter that came from the often quoted statement that true outlaw bikers only made up 1% of the motorcyclist community. Whether the statement was true or not, Gustav didn't give a damn. He just liked the feeling of elitism the statement struck within him, and he went with what he liked. They were traveling in full formation, so he carried his 1911 Colt jammed in his waistband, trusting in their numbers to keep any overeager cop from trying to roust him on a weapons charge. The rest of the gang were similarly armed, along with a few shotguns scattered among their numbers, and even a couple smaller machine pistols hidden here and there. Each of them only had one thought in their minds as they rode, and that was on what they were going to do when they reached their targets. Arlington was going to burn tonight, and tomorrow the machine would reign supreme. The rumble of bike engines announced the arrival of two more of their little group, and Alex waved a beer cheerfully at the familiar faces as they pulled their full helmets off. Charlie Ogre Crook climbed off his bike, and the grateful machine rose over half a foot on its shocks in response as the big man's 300-pound bulk left it. As big as ever, the 6'8" muscle builder had been a heavy weapons specialist in a force recon team assigned as a support unit to Alex's team during their tour in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Iran. The ogre of the 15th had been personally responsible for cracking a great many heads when one of Hale's detachment operations had gone disastrously wrong in June of 2012. Alex could still remember that op like it had happened yesterday, though he had wished he could forget it often enough. It had started as a routine sweep and clear through the streets of Baghdad, routing out a local terrorist cell claiming affiliation with the Sons of Allah the Vengeful, a splinter group that, despite its name, really had about as much connection with any known form of religion as a nuke did with a blasting cap. Intelligence claimed that the Sons only had 15 members, lightly armed and generally disorganized. Alex's squad was detached to clear them out because they'd recently arrived and were both experienced and fresh, something that few squads ever were at the same time over there. It was their first operation in Baghdad in over a year, but the streets hadn't changed much, other than getting a little more shot up and a little less repaired. Of course, what could one expect in a war zone? The trouble was that the Sons were neither 15 strong nor disorganized, and the first that anyone realized it was when 40 men caught Alex and his team in a crossfire ambush while they were clearing a building on the edge of the city. Two men had died on his team in the brief but savage firefight in exchange for at least 8 of the terrorists, but in the end, numbers had a quality all their own, and the squad had been overrun. They'd spent 8 days in the hands of the Sons before the force recon team located them and came in hot, hard, and angry as all hell. And the ugly son of a bitch that was Ogre Crook was leading them, picking off large chunks of anything that moved with a belt-fed HNK-23. Afterward, and in private, only after swearing each other to eternal secrecy, Alex and his team all agreed that they'd never seen a more beautiful sight than that ugly bastard kicking in a door and hosing down the room across from them. So he smiled at the pleasantly ugly face and nodded when Ogre grinned widely back at him, the smile splitting the man's face in two and baring big teeth that Alex knew were whispered to be used to grind bone into flour. Beside Ogre was another big man, though he looked like a featherweight in comparison. The 6'1" former Army Special Forces corporal had run into them at another time, a better time, During the bombing of Tehran, the detachment team led by Hale had been assigned to secure and defend a bunker about 3 miles south of the city, while a special forces team used the hill the bunker was built under to laze a priority target within the city. That mission had involved a minimum amount of interference from that old bastard Murphy, but Hale had met Stephen LeBeau, Green Beret's tracker from Louisiana. Sometimes Alex figured that fact alone filled up his quota for interference from Murphy for the entire 3 years that followed. Ogre Crook and Stefan Vert Chapeau had met later through Alex and had struck it off, oddly enough given the normal reaction Ogre had to anyone wearing army green. A reaction that generally ended in the person either being divested of his army green or being flung along with it out the nearest window. Or, alternatively, both. Ogre gave inter-service rivalry a whole new meaning.
"Hail!" Ogre boomed, laughing as he looked around. "Everyone here?"
"Not yet, Charlie," Hale said softly, his voice a tiny blip on the horizon compared to the booming quality of the bigger man. "We're still expecting the Sarge, not to mention Lana." Ogre's smile softened a little, and his eyes gleamed, letting Alex know that he hadn't gotten over his crush on the detachment's preferred Navy corpsman, Lana McPherson. The fiery redhead had missed her calling, as far as Alex was concerned. She should have been a Marine. He couldn't quite make himself regret her chosen vocation, however, given how many times she'd patched him and his team up. She was a petite 5'8", and looked absolutely tiny when standing side by side with Charlie, though none of his team were dumb enough to underestimate her because of her size. She'd been with them in Baghdad on that operation, and had spent the same 8 days in enemy hands as the rest of them. Thinking about it chilled his blood, even now, Alex realized as he took a reflexive pull on his can of beer in an attempt to kill the brain cells that contained that particular memory. When it happened, he'd been wild, unable to think. Afterwards, Alex was ashamed to remember that he'd become strongly opposed to the sweeping changes that had placed Lana in that situation in the first place. Equal rights had their place, he knew, but after that mission, the chauvinistic side of him had taken over. He'd sworn up and down that he'd never take another woman into a combat situation again, regulations be damned. Alex smiled slightly, remembering Lana herself striding up to him shortly afterwards and ripping a strip off his ass for saying that. What they'd done to his men during those 8 days didn't bear thinking on, but they'd survived. That was enough, in Alex's opinion. But what had happened to Lana had been so much worse, or so he'd thought at the time. She set him straight on that, though. McPherson had a way of doing that. He supposed that he really was chauvinistic, but in his eyes, what they did to her was so much worse than his own scars and broken bones. They'd done things to her right in front of his team that still woke him at night in cold sweats. But she'd treated it like it was nothing worse than what he'd gotten. Maybe it wasn't. Hale didn't know. He couldn't say. From where he sat, the pain he received was transitory, to be endured and then forgotten. Lana told him that it was the same for her, but he didn't really believe her. Not deep down. Not at first, anyway. Later, when she'd soldiered up and kept on pushing ahead like the rest of the team, he'd started to believe. She didn't talk about what happened much, but neither did any of them talk about what happened to them. Alex didn't like to even think about when he'd broken down and finally cried, pain and sleep deprivation ripping down all the composure he'd struggled to maintain, so he couldn't really be surprised that she felt the same. She joked about it from time to time, like they all did about their scars. That was what soldiers did.
at least among friends. They didn't talk about it at all with anyone else. Hale had finally decided, a long time ago, that Lana was either the strongest person he'd ever met, or maybe she'd told him the truth when she said that it wasn't any worse than what the rest of them got, just different. For himself, Hale was leaning toward her just being stronger than anyone else he'd ever worked with, but for her sake and at her request, he reserved judgment. He still wasn't a huge proponent of women in combat, but if that was where they wanted to be, then so be it. He figured that as long as they were asking to serve, and not just being sent there, they deserved the right to choose. He chuckled softly. As long as they asked. Yeah, he thought in amusement, Lana was right. I am a chauvinist. Soldiers and killers. He'd met both in his life and career, both in his allies and in his enemies. Lana was a soldier, even if she swung a med kit more often than she swung a rifle. The men who had captured them back then, they were killers. Hale had often thought that the quality of an army was in how high a percentage of soldiers over killers it had. Every army had both, that was inevitable. He was proud to say that his Marines had far fewer killers than any army they'd fought against, but he had seen that even they had their share. Hale finished his can of beer, a familiar melancholy setting in, and reached for another one. His hand was stopped by a surprisingly firm grip from a brown-skinned hand wrapped around his wrist. "You might want to chat a while before you take another one, Cap," Rosie told him seriously. "You're getting that look again." Alex nodded, smiling. "Yeah, that's a good idea, Rosie." "I know it," she told him, her teeth gleaming against her dark face.
"Ranger Wood, glad to see you," the man wearing a ranger's star identical to Wood's said as he shook hands. "Good to meet you, Ranger Sanchez," Wood replied, ending the handshake before looking around. "This everyone?" Sanchez nodded, looking over the gathering of Texas Rangers, state police, and SWAT officers from Arlington, Dallas, and even from as far away as Houston. "Yeah, this is it. We've got 4 SWAT teams, 200 state police, and 50 Rangers. If this play holds off another day, we can get another 100-150 officers, and maybe some National Guardsmen. If it holds off another day, we can arrest Rev, Keegan, and the rest of the leadership of both gangs and maybe head this off altogether," Wood replied grimly. "But I don't think it will." Sanchez sighed, shaking his head. "This is gonna be ugly." "Don't I know it, Sanchez?" Wood shook his head. "If I had my way, we'd stand back and let them blow the ever-living shit out of each other. But I don't know if they'll be kind enough to handle their shit far enough away from civilized folk." "Well, we've got 6 choppers airborne right now, following members of both gangs," Sanchez offered weakly. "If we see them coming together, we can try to head them off before it gets out of control." "Might as well spit into a tornado, and you know it." Sanchez nodded reluctantly, sighing. "Yeah, I know it." The sound of a cell phone ringing hushed the drunken sounds of celebratory drinking, and the stoned, drunk, and generally inebriated bikers fell into some form of order as Warren Keegan tugged the tiny mobile from his pocket and flipped it open. "Talk to me." Keegan nodded a couple times, just listening, and gave no impression to those listening what he was hearing over the electronic device. He just smiled after a moment, then shut the phone and waved Mickey over. "What's up?" the big man asked, grabbing an old bucket and flipping it over to sit on the bottom. "That's my man inside the machine," Keegan said quietly. Mickey didn't say anything, just froze for a moment. He'd suspected that Keegan had someone on the inside, but this was the first time the other man had mentioned it.
They're here in Arlington now, Warren said with a satisfied look. Right on time.
How many?
All of them, Warren replied. Someone cursed in the darkness, but was ignored.
Shit, man. That's a lot of guns.
Getting cold feet, Mickey? Keegan asked, his voice taunting just slightly.
Fuck yes, Mickey replied, forcing a hollow laugh. Don't mean I'm gonna quit, though.
Warren nodded, not saying anything as he looked at his lieutenant with dark eyes.
What now?
Mickey asked after a long silence.
Now? Warren grinned. Now we saddle up. Hope you boys ain't too drunk to ride.
Laughing cheers erupted around them, spreading out and through the gathering of people. There were only a couple hundred there, about 100 of them wearing bona fide raven colors, the rest just hangers-on. The rest were around in other places in Arlington, along with more hangers-on and wannabes. Keegan flipped open his phone again, dialing a number out, and waited for it to connect.
It's me, he said into the phone. It's time.
The roar of Harley engines woke Hale from a fitful sleep, and the 38-year-old groaned slightly as he rolled out of the sleeping bag and climbed to his feet. He'd swear that his back was just waiting for him to turn 40 before it actually started to creak. He glanced down at the bedding, shaking his head tiredly. There had been a time when sleeping on one of the military self-inflating bedding pads was just like curling up in his bed at home, but those days were long gone. Christ, 38, and I'm over the fucking hill, Hale thought to himself in disgust. I've got to get out more often. A useless pledge, the former Marine knew it even as he thought it, and one he'd made so many times before. Truth was, he liked the comfort of his life now. His wife, his job at the university, they were what he'd worked for. The increased sound of engines broke his musings, and Hale crawled forward to where he spotted T, leaning against the edge of the grounds picnic table.
What's up, Squid?
T's teeth flashed in the light of the dozens, no, hundreds of bike headlights rolling down the hill into the park grounds.
Bikes, Cap. Lots of them. Started coming in about 7 minutes ago. Guess they didn't know you needed your beauty sleep.
Stuff it, T, Hale replied, his voice mostly joking. I didn't know there was a gathering this weekend.
There isn't, T said softly, chewing idly on a long piece of grass he'd plucked from near the table legs.
So what's this?
Can't tell from here, but I think it's the machine, Cap.
What machine? Alex asked, frowning. T chuckled. The machine. The biker gang.
Oh, that machine.
Hale had heard of them, of course. They were in the news often enough. They were a guaranteed way to sell papers or airtime on news shows.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.